Prabhu, I think we exchanged the book. Can you please? Yeah, yeah. I have a bookmark there, yeah. Namanand Sakha Prabhu, can we start? Yeah, okay. We'd like to welcome everybody online to the auspicious occasion of Sri Ram Navami. This happens to be also the first anniversary of our moving into this new temple. We are very pleased that the Lordships have a new home here, and Ram Navami has become very special for ISV because it marks the anniversary for us acquiring this new temple for the Lordship. Today we are going to continue on reading of Ramayana. We are following the book which is translated by His Holiness Bhakti Vikas Swami, The Story of Lord Ram. And Mataji, if you need a copy, behind Prabhu has kept it, so you can also follow together. Okay? We have read till page number 517, and we'll continue reading till we finish this as part of this yajna. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Gyan Anjana Salakaya Chakshu Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya, Prabhu Nityananda, Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivas Adi Gaurav Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Continuing the reading from page 518, from the top, 518. Thereafter a sacrificial fire was lit, and when their friendship was thus formalized, Ravana and Vali warmly embraced. Ravana continued to reside as Kishkindya for 1 month as the honored guest of the monkey chief. At this point, Rama said, O Rishi, Ravana and Vali were certainly powerful heroes, but I feel that Hanuman's prowess exceeds both of them. Indeed, during my conquest of Lanka, it was he alone who enabled me to become victorious and recover Sita. I cannot properly express my debt to Hanuman, the best of my unalloyed servitors. O great sage, I still have doubt that I pray you can dispel. Why is it that when there was enmity between Vali and Sugriva, that Hanuman did not vanquish Vali? I think Hanuman could not have been aware of his prowess. Otherwise, how could he stood by idly and watch Sugriva suffer? O foremost of rishis, you are the knower of all mysterious truths. Therefore, please explain the transcendental pastimes of Hanuman so my doubts can be removed. Hanuman was also present in the assembly, listening to the conversation, and he experienced great transcendental bliss upon hearing Rama's statement. The great sage Agastya then answered, It is true that no one can equal Hanuman in strength, speed, or intelligence. However, it so happened that he forgot his actual prowess. I will recount the story of his life to explain why. Hanuman was begot by Vayu through Anjana, the wife of Kesari, a monkey chief who used to reside on Mount Meru. After delivering the child, Anjana went to gather some fruit for him. In her absence, however, the hungry baby started to cry. At that time, the sun began to rise. When the baby monkey saw the luminous orange globe, he thought that it was a fruit and suddenly sprang upwards and catch it. When the demigod saw that the son of Vayu flying swiftly through the air, they became astonished, declaring, Not even the mind or Garuda can move so fast. If this monkey shows so much ability as a baby, what will he be like when he grows up? Vayu followed his son to protect him from the scorching heat of the sunshine. Then as the baby monkey approached, Surya refrained from consuming him in consideration of his childish innocence and the future mission he would perform on behalf of Ram. Thus the son of Vayu was able to take his seat upon the chariot next to Surya. Just at that time, Rahu happened to come to attack the sun god. Instinctively, the baby monkey grabbed Rahu, but in the next moment, Rahu, the worst of the planetary controllers, slipped from his clutches. Rahu fearfully approached Indra and complained, Although I have been allotted the sun and moon as a means for appeasing my hunger, it appears that my share has been appropriated by another. Just now, when I approached the sun god, I saw that another Rahu was attacking him. Indra was quite astonished to hear this, and he thus mounted Airavata and set out towards the sun. Rahu had gone ahead, and when the son of Vayu saw him coming, he considered him to be a type of gigantic fruit, and sprang from Surya's chariot to catch him. Rahu immediately began to flee, crying out for Indra's protection. Thus the king of heaven, who approached from nearby, gave him assurance. This is such nice pastimes, you know. Then when the hungry baby sighted Airavata, he took the elephant to be an enormous white fruit and rushed towards him. When Indra saw the son of Vayu approaching, he immediately released his thunderbolt. The baby monkey crashed down on a mountain, broke his jaw, and thus gave up his life. This enraged Vayu, who then took his son and withdrew into a mountain cave. Vayu ceased acting as the air of respiration, and all living entities began to suffocate, their bowels and bladders becoming obstructed. With bloated bellies, the demigods hurriedly approached Lord Brahma, anxiously informing him of their plight. Lord Brahma said, "O celestials, it is due to Vayu's anger that you are now suffering. Just try to understand the importance of the wind god. Although he has no perceivable material body, he moves within the body of all created beings. Indeed, without the wind, a material body is no better than a block of wood. Therefore, I suggest that we all approach Vayu and pacify him for the welfare of the entire world." Lord Brahma led the demigods to Vayu's cave. The wind god was tormented by the death of his son, whose body he still held in his arms. After Vayu offered his obeisances, Lord Brahma affectionately placed his hand upon the baby's monkey head and immediately brought him back to life. Upon the revival of his son, Vayu resumed circulating within all creatures. Thus the living entities again became joyful. Lord Brahma then told the assembled demigods, "In the future, this child will act for your welfare. Thus all of you should award him benedictions." Hearing Lord Brahma's command, Indra took off his garland of lotus flowers and placed it around Hanuman's neck. Indra declared, "Because of his broken jaw, this child will henceforth be known as Hanuman. He need not longer fear my thunderbolt, for he will immune to its effect. Hare Krishna. The sun god announced, "I hereby donate 1% of my billions to Hanuman. Furthermore, I grant him full knowledge of the scripture and benedict him with eloquent speech." Yamaraj then said, "I hereby grant Hanuman immunity from my rod of death and from all diseases." Kuvera declared, "Let Hanuman be immune to my mace and never become tired in battle." Lord Shiva said, "I grant that Hanuman will never be killed by me or any of my weapons." Lord Shiva said, "I grant that Hanuman will never be killed by me." Okay, Lord Shiva. So right now we are reading Ramayana, Mataji, in case you want to also hear. You can grab a copy if you wish. Okay. Matak will tell you, yeah. Yes. Vishwakarma announced, "I award Hanuman the benediction that he cannot be killed by any weapon I have manufactured." Lastly, Lord Brahma said, "I grant Hanuman a long life, magnanimity, immunity to the Brahmastra, and immunity to the curses of the Brahmanas." Lord Brahma then said to Vayu, "This child will be able to change his form at will and shall be unconquerable. He will be able to travel wherever he likes and at any speed he chooses. In the future, he will perform glorious activities that will aid in the destruction of Ravana. Thus, he will become very pleasing to Lord Ram." The demigods departed, and Vayu placed Hanuman under the care of his mother Anjana. After receiving so many benedictions, Hanuman was bursting with energy. He began acting fearlessly. Sometimes he even offended prominent rishis by interrupting their sacrifices and breaking their paraphernalia. While Hanuman indulged in these pranks, the rishis tolerated him, for they knew that he was immune to death from their curses due to Lord Brahma's benediction. Hanuman's foster father Keshari and his natural father Vayu tried their best to discipline him. Still, Hanuman continues to transgress the bounds of propriety. Thus the rishis became a little angered at him and declared that, "For now you shall remain ignorant of your true prowess. At the proper time you will again become aware of your full potency." Thereafter Hanuman began wandering through the forest in a peaceful mood. At this time the king of the monkeys, Rikshaj succumbed to death from old age. His eldest son Vali assumed the throne, while Sugriva became heir apparent. From childhood, Hanuman and Sugriva were best friends. However, when hostility broke out between the two brothers, Hanuman was not aware of his true prowess, and thus he did not help Sugriva fight Vali. Page 522. Because of his ignorance of his great power, Hanuman became more interested in the cultivation of knowledge than the exhibition of force. To learn all areas of Vedic knowledge, he would follow the sun god the full distance from where he rises to where he sets. Hanuman would put forward innumerable questions, and eventually he became as learned in the Vedas as Brihaspati. In this way, Agastya Rishi described the glories of Hanuman. Rama, Lakshman and the monkey chiefs were amazed and delighted to hear them. When the assembled rishis decided to go, Rama said, "Now that I have been installed as emperor, I want to perform many sacrifices for the welfare of the world. I request that you all return home so that the sacrifices may be performed under your supervision." Happily giving their consent, the rishis departed. The next morning, awakened by the professional singers who recited his glories, Rama bathed and sat down to perform fire sacrifices. Thereafter, Ram visited the palace temple and proceeded to the royal court. Seated upon the royal throne and surrounded by his ministers, servants and 20 of monkey chiefs, Rama administered the state government in an exemplary manner. King Janaka was one of the many great kings that came to Ayodhya to attend Rama's coronation. After some time, Rama approached him saying, "My dear father-in-law, you should now return to your kingdom, Vidarbha, lest it becomes neglected. Bharat and Shatrughna will escort you there with a large army." Janaka consented, and Rama honored him with many valuable presentations. Janaka gave all the presents to his beloved daughter, Sita, and happily departed for home. Rama then addressed his maternal uncle, the Kekaya king, Yudhaji. "Because your father is now very old, you too should return to your kingdom to take care of him. Lakshmana will accompany you with a large army." Yudhajit gave his consent, and after his departure, Rama bid farewell to his friend, the king of Kashi. Altogether, Rama bade farewell to 300 kings and princes that had come to Ayodhya to celebrate his coronation. After returning home, all these kings sent their escorts back with many valuable presentations for Ram. When he received all these gifts, Ram immediately gave them away to Sugriva, Vibhishana and the other monkeys and Rakshasas. One day Rama took Hanuman and Angad upon his lap and told Sugriva, "These two great heroes deserve every possible honor." Rama then took off the ornament from his body and decorated Hanuman and Angada with them. The other monkey heroes were also present, and so Ram sweetly said, You are all not only my dear friends, but are just like my brothers." Rama embraced all the monkeys and gave them various presents. All the monkeys remained in Ayodhya for more than 1 month, happily spending their time feasting and relishing the association of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Ramchandra. However, due to their great love for Ram, the time passed so quickly that it seemed to the monkeys to be less than 1 hour. After the month has passed, Rama requested Sugriva to return to Kishkindhya and Vibhishana to return to Lanka. At this time, Hanuman came before him and offered the following prayers. "O my Lord, may my devotion for you always remain steady, and may my love for you never become diverted towards anyone else. In addition, may my life continue for as long as the narration of your transcendental pastimes is recited upon the earth. Indeed, only by hearing the recitations of the Ramayana will I be able to mitigate the unbearable pangs of separation from you." You know, we know that Ram also met during Krishna's pastimes, correct? So, Hanuman was still there in Krishna's pastime. So Hanuman is still around as long as we'll read Ramayana and glorify Lord Ram. Rama then got down from his throne and while embracing Hanuman declared, "Your life shall continue for as long as the Ramayana is recited." Ramayana ki jai. Indeed, the Ramayana will be recited for as long as the earth continues to exist. "My dear Hanuman, I shall never be able to repay you for the service you have rendered unto me. I will remain eternally indebted. Rama took off the necklace of pearls and precious stone that decorated his chest and placed it around Hanuman's neck. All the monkeys then got up and one by one bowed down to Lord Ram. Thereafter, Rama embraced Sugriva and Vibhishana, and the monkeys' eyes became filled with tears, their minds bewildered from the ecstatic feeling of impending separation, and their speech indistinct. Finally, the monkeys departed. Rama felt great separation from his servants, but he was also happy that the heroes would be reunited with their families. Later that afternoon, Rama suddenly heard a voice from the sky. Looking up, he saw that the Pushpaka chariot was addressing him. The chariot told Ram, "I returned to Kaivera as you ordered. However, the Lord of the Well told me, because Ram has conquered Ravana, you now rightly belong to him. Thus I have been sent back by Kuvera to render service unto you. O Lord, please accept me without hesitation." Ram worshipped the Pushpak chariot with flowers, incense and sandalwood paste, and then ordered him, "If I am ever in need of your service, you can appear to me when called for. In the meantime, you are free to go wherever you please." Being so directed, the Pushpaka chariot departed to wander on its own. Sometime after this incident, Bharata came one day before Ram and began to glorify his rule of the kingdom, saying, "Although little more than 1 month has passed since your coronation, there is already a complete absence of disease, untimely death and labor pains for women. The clouds are showering rains at the proper time, and thus all the people are in joyous state of mind." Rama felt great bliss listening to Bharata's praise, for he understood that all living entities can obtain the highest fulfillment of life in a God-conscious kingdom. The winter passed, and with the arrival of spring, Rama passed much of his time with Sita in the lovely palace gardens. During the day, Rama would dutifully carry out the state administration, and in the evenings he would sit with Sita in the shade of large Ashoka tree. Surrounding them, the Apsaras sang and danced among the flowering trees. Rama, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and Sita, the Goddess of Fortune, passed each day enjoying newer and newer delights. Their pleasure in each other's association expanded unlimitedly. One day, Rama understood that Sita was pregnant. He expressed his great pleasure, saying, "O lovely princess, is there any desire within your heart that you feel has yet not been gratified? Please inform me if there is, for I shall fulfill your every wish without fail." Sita replied, "O Lord, in your association all my desires have been abundantly fulfilled. However, since you are asking, I admit I have a strong desire to visit the ashram of the rishis situated on the banks of the Ganga and offer my obeisances to the great saints living there." Rama assured her, "My dear Sita, please know that very soon you will have the opportunity to visit the rishis in the forest." Thereafter, Rama entered the royal assembly and engaged in joking and light conversation with his advisors. Rama then asked Bharda, "What do the citizens talk about these days? What do you say about Sita, Lakshman? What do they say about Sita, Lakshman, Bharat and Shatrughna? How do they feel about our mother Kekai and myself? Indeed, kings are always the topic of criticism for the people." With folded hands, Bharda replied, "O Lord, everyone praises your victory over the ten-headed Ravana. They acclaim you are the greatest of all heroes." Rama, however, urged, "Tell me truthfully what they say. Only by knowing matters as they are can one curtail his faults and thus endeavor for self-improvement. O Bharda, there is no need for you to be afraid. I have already understood that envious people are spreading rumors about me through Ayodhya. I have been personally heard some people criticize me for taking back a woman who remained so long in the house of another." Hearing this, Bharda bowed to Rama and replied, "Whether good or bad, I do not know. However, this is what people are saying in the marketplaces and in the city streets. Rama has performed an extraordinary feat by bridging the ocean and vanquishing the powerful Ravana. However, has it occurred to him that he has brought home a woman who was abducted by the Rakshasa king and forced to sit upon his lap? Does Rama not feel disgust at enjoying a woman who remained with Ravana for almost one entire year? "O Lord, these are the things people are speaking about you." Shocked and dismayed to hear this, Rama then asked the other ministers if what Bhadra had said was true. They all confirmed it was so. Ram was fully aware of Sita's complete purity and innocence, but he could not tolerate the shame of having to hear that people were mocking him in this way. Rama made up his mind to abandon his unsuspecting wife and call for Lakshmana. Rama addressed his brother with great agitation. "O Lakshmana, please listen with great attention, for what I have to say is most painful. I have just learned that some citizens of Ayodhya condemn me for taking Sita back from the kingdom of Lanka. Just see how distressed I have become. I have appeared in the royal dynasty of Ikshavaku. Thus any taint of dishonor to my name brings me more grief than the thought of death. After killing Ravana, I also considered, how can I take Sita back to Ayodhya? It was just to allay these doubts that I made the princess of Vidarbha enter the fire in the presence of all the demigods and rishis. Vayu and Agni declared that Sita was pure, and within my heart I also knew she was chaste, so I accepted her back. Now, however, rumors are spreading everywhere and I am being blamed in my own kingdom. O Lakshmana, a person who is the target of rumors suffers great humiliation and defamation. Ill deeds are always condemned, and that is what motivates the noble-minded towards good acts. I am ready to give up my life if necessary to avoid public scandal. Indeed, I am ready to renounce you, my dear brother, for ensuring my good name and reputation. Thus, what can be said of Sita? I am drowning in an ocean of sorrow. Never before have I experienced such misfortune. Lakshmana, tomorrow at dawn, you must take Sita to the banks of the Ganga and take her on the tour of the ashram of the great rishis. Then abandon her near the hermitage of the great sage Valmiki on the banks of the river Tamasa and return to Ayodhya alone. My dear brother, you must carry out this order without any argument, for any slight hesitation on your part will bring me the greatest displeasure. Indeed, let it be known that anyone who objects to my decision immediately becomes my most bitter enemy. Just a little while ago, Sita told me she is very eager to visit all the ashrams along the banks of the Ganga. Now go and fulfill her desire." So everything is transcendently arranged. There's a footnote number 9, and we'll read that. It is often queried why Lord Ram banished Sita simply because of some small criticism. It appeared that Lord Ram was harsh and cruel to his chaste wife. However, Lord Ram, as an ideal king, had to uphold the honor of his dynasty and set an impeccable example for all generations to follow. Had he not banished Sita, lesser monarchs in the future could have used this as an excuse not to respond to valid criticisms by their citizens. Rama's decision may seem harsh, but to properly rule it, it is required that the king sometimes be harsh. His first duty is to rule the people. Other considerations are secondary, even if they affect his personal happiness or that of his own family members. So positions come up with a lot of pressure. Lakshmana became, continuing on page 531, Lakshmana became broken-hearted to hear Ram speak like this. However, since he was the obedient servant of his elder brother, he assented without hesitation. Then early the next morning, Lakshmana went to Sita and said, "Your husband has ordered me to fulfill your desire. I shall escort you to the bank of the Ganga so that you can worship the great rishis residing there. Sumantra is ready with a chariot, so I request you come at once." Ramanand Sakha Prabhu. Yeah. There is mic also. I wish if all of you can read one paragraph also. You know, I want you to participate in the yagya also. Can you just on the set? Yeah.
Just one thing is that I want to mute. Because
okay.
I want to hear.
Okay.
Just, this is great.
We'll just circulate one problem.
And then if you press once, it gets muted. When not speaking, press once. And then when you want, press once.
So green is on.
Yeah. Mataji, if you can read the Sita was delighted.
Sita was delighted, and after putting on her finest dress and most exquisite jewelry, she told Lakshmana, I shall distribute these and other gifts to the wives of the great sages. Lakshmana helped Sita onto the chariot and they quickly departed. However, while going along, Sita began to speak anxiously, saying, O Lakshmana, my left eye has suddenly began to twitch and my mind feels strangely uneasy. Suddenly I feel very weak and the earth seems to have taken a gloomy aspect. I hope Rama is all right.
Thank you so much. You can give it to Prabhu.
Sita prayed to the demigods for the welfare of her husband and other relatives. Lakshmana then said in a voice choked with tears, I hope you too will not meet with misfortune. By evening, Sita, Lakshmana and Sumatra reached the banks of river Gomati and spent the night there. Early the next morning, they continued their journey. But by afternoon, they came to the banks of Ganga. Upon dismounting the chariot, however, Lakshman broke down and cried, for he could no longer contain his grief. Feeling great concern, Sita inquired, O Lakshman, what is wrong? Now that we have reached our destination, you should be happy. Indeed, your sadness makes me so uneasy. Have just 2 days passed of separation from Rama brought you so much anguish. I love Rama dearly, yet I have not become so disturbed. Please compose yourself, for we must now cross the Ganges to have the audience of the great rishis. Thereafter we can quickly return to Ayodhya, for I also long to see Rama.
Mataji, you want to read one paragraph? After wiping
the tears from his eyes, Lakshmana arranged for a boat and escorted Sita across the Ganga. Upon reaching the other side, Lakshmana tearfully confessed, O Princess of Vidarbha, the all good Lord Ram has entrusted me with a most painful task. Indeed, by performing this duty, I shall become infamous in the eyes of the world. It would have been better if I had died rather than execute your husband's order. O noble lady, please forgive me for what I am being forced to do.
Thank you. You can put on mute, yeah. Lakshmana fell to the ground, weeping bitterly. With great indignation, Sita asked, O Lakshmana, what is the matter? I cannot understand what you are saying. Please tell me clearly what is troubling you. Has some great misfortune befallen Ram that you do not have the courage to tell me? With his head bowed low, Lakshmana replied in a voice choked with tears. While sitting in the royal court, Rama learned that rumors were circulating throughout Ayodhya, accusing him of impropriety. Everywhere people blame Ram for accepting you back. This public censure pains him unbearably. O Sita, I know that you are faultless and so does Ram. Therefore, do not misunderstand the king, for he has been forced to relinquish you to maintain the good name of the Ikshvaku dynasty. O Princess of Vidarbha, do not be broken-hearted, for the abodes of the Brahma Rishi that are situated on the banks of the Ganga are celestially beautiful. Welcome, Palla Prabhu. We are reading Ramayana. You can grab a book from behind and Prabhu will tell you where we are. You should take shelter of the great sage Valmiki, for he was a good friend of your father-in-law, Maharaj Dashratha. Always think of Ram within your heart and remain unflinchingly devoted to him. In this way, you will attain the highest happiness, O Janaki. Upon hearing of her cruel destiny, Sita immediately fainted. Then coming to her senses, she pitifully cried out, Now I can see that this life was awarded to me simply for suffering. What great sin did I commit in the past? What poor girl's marriage did I obstruct to now cause Ram to cast me off? I faithfully followed my husband into exile and remain content despite innumerable hardships. O Lakshmana, how shall I be able to survive here alone? What will I tell the rishis when they ask me why I was abandoned? What wrong have I done? I would gladly end my life by throwing myself onto the Ganga, but that would bring about the end of Ram's dynasty. Becoming somewhat more composed, Sita told Lakshmana, I know that you are merely carrying out your duty. I do not blame you. Go back to Ayodhya now and offer my respects to my mother-in-laws. Touch the feet of my husband and please deliver the following message. O Ram, you know that my devotion has always been fixed upon you without deviation. You know of my chastity and my unfailing love. Still from fear of dishonor and shame, you have swung me. O Ram, my Lord and only refuge, you should not have done so. My dear husband, I do not grieve for my own misfortune, for I know that I am faultless. For a chaste woman, the husband is as good as God. Therefore, I must accept that whatever you may order is best for my welfare, even if it means giving up my life. Lakshmana circumambulated Sita and crossed to the Ganga opposite shore. As Lakshmana mounted his chariot, he turned his head just to have one last glimpse of Sita. Likewise, Sita gazed sorrowfully at Lakshman's as he receded into the distance. Then, alone and unprotected, Sita fell onto the ground, crying uncontrollably. The grief-stricken Lakshmana said, O Sumantra, what terrible pain Ram will have to suffer now that he has abandoned his dear wife. Alas, he who worthfully destroyed the Rakshasas appeared to be himself ruled by cruel destiny. The sorrow Ram will feel shall far exceed what he experienced while living in exile under the order of his father. Sumantra replied, O prince, do not become overly aggrieved because of Sita or Ram. Long ago, your father was informed that one day Ram would have to abandon his wife and suffer the pangs of separation for the remainder of his life. O Lakshmana, I promise your father that I would never disclose all of this. However, since you have inquired about Rama's misfortune, I shall tell you everything. I should certainly obey the king's order, but it appears that fate is indeed supreme, and I feel impelled to speak. However, please do not repeat any of this to Bharata or Shatrughna. Lakshmana exclaimed, O Sumantra, please disclose everything. Sumantra said, O prince, once upon a time, Durvasa Muni resided at the ashram of Vasishtha during the 4 months of the rainy season to execute the required penances for that season. One day when Maharaj Dasharatha came to visit Vasishtha, he saw Durvasa Muni seated by the rishi's side. Thus he respectfully worshipped both sages. In turn, the two rishis welcomed Maharaj Dasharatha and invited him to sit down with them. In the course of their conversation, Maharaj Dasharatha asked about his own longevity along with that of his sons. Durvasa Muni told him, My dear king, once long ago, when the Daitya were hard-pressed in battle against the demigods, they took shelter of Bhrugu Muni's wife, for she had previously assured them of protection. Seeing this, Lord Vishnu became enraged, and by employing his Sudarshana Chakra, he severed the head of the ascetic woman. In retaliation, Bhrugu Muni angrily cursed Lord Vishnu to be born upon the earth as human being and suffer the pangs of separation from his wife. See, so beautiful, correct? Everything, you know, like a jigsaw puzzle tied together. And you know, this was another thing, like after this, Lakshman is again Balram, correct? After that, he never took birth as a junior brother to him. He always became senior. So whether it was Nityananda Prabhu in Gaura Leela or Balram in Krishna Leela, so he can take more control. Here, Ram used to order and used to listen, correct? So at that way, you know, so it's so nectarian. After venting his anger in this way, however, Bhrigu Muni became sorry. Repentantly, he began to worship Lord Vishnu. The Lord became satisfied with Bhrigu Muni and he voluntarily agreed to accept the consequences of Rishi's curse. My dear Dashrath, it is for this reason that Lord Vishnu has appeared as your son Ram. From Ayodhya, he will rule over the earth for 11,000 years. And two sons will be born unto him through the womb of his beloved wife Janaki. Sumantra then said, My dear Lakshmana, all this was foretold by the great sage Durvasa to your father. Now you should give up your grief, knowing well that whatever takes place is in accordance with the will of the Supreme Lord. Hearing Sumantra words, Lakshmana felt great relief and expressed his sincere gratitude to the chief minister. We can also apply this in our life, correct? Whatever happens is by the will of the Lord. And then we will not have pains and suffering. Lakshmana and Sumantra passed the night on the banks of the river and the next morning resumed their journey. Some disciples of Valmiki happened to see Sita weeping and they ran to their master saying, "O master, come quickly. There is a woman who resembles the goddess of fortune herself, sitting alone in the forest crying." By dint of his mystic power, Valmiki could understand everything. He rushed to the place where the bereaved Sita sat. The Rishi humbly approached her and said, "O devoted wife of Lord Ram, O daughter of the King Janaka, by the strength of my austerities, I know all that takes place within the three worlds. Thus I understand your plight. Please do not be afraid. Near my ashram, there are ascetic women who will devotedly care for you as if you were their daughter. Please come with me now and consider this to be your own. Please come with me now and consider this to be your new home. Valmiki then took Sita and placed her under the care of the female ascetics. Meanwhile, Lakshmana arrived at Ayodhya. Wondering what he would say, he entered the royal palace. Lakshmana saw Rama seated upon the throne, shedding tears and lost in deep contemplation. Seeing his elder brother's pitiful condition, Lakshmana's eyes also filled with tears. Bowing down before Lord Ram, Lakshmana addressed him in a voice laden with great sorrow. "My dear brother, in accordance with your order, I abandoned Sita on the banks of the Ganga near the ashram of the great sage Valmiki. O Ram, there is no use giving way to grief. Indeed, in this world, meeting and separation are concomitant factors. It is inevitable that one's wife, one's son, and one's very life must one day be given up. Therefore, intelligent persons always pass through life's journey with an attitude of detachment. My dear brother, your unlimited prowess controls the three worlds. Why then do you not suppress this despondency? Cost of this weakness, otherwise more rumors will circulate. What will people think?" Rama became pacified by Lakshmana's word and his grief gradually faded. Rama said, "My dear Lakshmana, for the last 4 days, I have completely neglected my royal duties. Please summon all the royal ministers, priests and people in general with whom you do business. The king who does not look daily at the state administration is certainly doomed to suffer in hell. You must know the story of King Nagra. He once gave away millions of cow in charity to a Brahmana, but one of them happened to belong to another Brahmana. When they discovered this discrepancy, the Brahmana cursed the king to become a lizard. It was ordained that King Nagra would be delivered in the distant future when Lord Vishnu would appear as the son of Vasudev in the line of Yadu. Even now, that great king suffers because of the Brahmana's curse. Thus, it can be understood just how much misery can be incurred due to the king's injustice. Therefore, let all people come to me who seek my audience. My dear brother, if you wish, I can entertain you with other interesting histories regarding the lives of great kings." See, everybody knew that Krishna will come later. As we know, Kalki will come, correct? So, all the things in Bhagavatam and Puranas and Vedas are truth, axiomatic truth. There is no single deviation from them, correct? Lakshmana replied, "My dear Ram, the more I listen to these wonderful stories, the more I am eager to continue hearing." In response, Rama narrated the history of King Nimi. This 12th king of Ikshvaku once asked Vasishtha to officiate at his sacrifice. However, because Vasishtha was already engaged in performing a sacrifice on behalf of Indra, he requested Maharaj Nimi to wait. But instead of waiting, Maharaj Nimi appointed Gautama as his sacrificial priest. When Vasishtha learned of this, he came to the king and cursed him to die. In retaliation, Maharaj Nimi cursed Vasishtha to die. And thereafter, they were both forced to relinquish their material bodies. Anger. Vasishtha then approached Lord Brahma, who advised him to enter the semen about to be discharged by Mitra and Varuna. Vasishtha quickly went onto the shore of the ocean where Mitra and Varuna were residing. Just at that time, the beautiful Apsara Urvashi came by. Becoming overwhelmed by lust, Varuna pleaded with Urvashi to accept him. But Urvashi replied that Mitra was first to beg union with her. At this, Varuna declared, "O beautiful one, if you do not accept my embrace at once, I shall discharge my semen into this celestial pitcher." Being pleased by this statement of ardent love, Urvashi replied, "My dear Varuna, although my body belongs to Mitra, my heart belongs to you." Mitra became extremely irritated at Urvashi's words and cursed the Apsara to pass some time on earth. Mitra was first to discharge his semen into the celestial pitcher. As a result, the great sage Agastya rose from the vessel and said, "O Mitra, I am your only begotten son." Saying this, Agastya went away. Then after Varuna discharged his semen into the pitcher, it mixed with the semen of Mitra. Thus, from the mixture, Vasishtha took birth. Welcome, Prabhu. Happy Ram Navami. You can also take a book, and we are reading Ramayana, so you can follow along. Welcome. Meanwhile, after the death of Maharaj Nimi, the priest continued the sacrifice after preserving his body in oil. At the contemplation of the sacrifice, Bhrigumuni utilized his mystic powers to invoke the soul of King Nimi. The demigods were very pleased with this act, and when they offered him a benediction, Maharaj Nimi requested, "O celestials, may I always reside in the eyes of all creatures." The demigods gave their consent, saying, "O king, you shall visit every eye in the form of air. Because of this, all creatures will be seen to blink periodically." You understand now the science of blinking? Because of Maharaj Nimi. Thus, the demigods departed, and therefore, thereafter, the priests began to churn the body of King Nimi. Thus, Mithi was born. Since he was born from a dead body, he was known as Videha as well as Janaka. After narrating this story, Rama hastened to the royal assembly, eager to attend to the duties of state administration. There, Ram ordered Lakshmana, "Go to the palace gate and bring me all those who have come with their petitions." Lakshmana soon returned, saying, "O Lord, it appears that there is no one in the Kaushala kingdom who is in need of anything." Rama, however, insisted, "Go again and look more carefully. I do not wish to be accused of the slightest neglect, nor do I want the least bit of irreligion to go undetected in my kingdom." Going out again, Lakshmana then noticed a dog sitting near the palace gate, its head bleeding. While staring at Lakshmana, the dog whined mournfully. Lakshmana asked, "What is wrong? Why have you come here? Please do not fear, for you may tell me everything." The dog replied, "I wish to speak directly to Lord Ram, whose lotus feet award one fearlessness, and who is the shelter of the distressed." Lakshmana then said, "If you have something to say, then you are welcome to come speak to the king himself." However, the dog replied, "I am a very low-born creature. I am unworthy of entering temples, the houses of Brahmanas, or royal palaces. The king, in the embodiment of all religious principles, the representation of all the demigods, and the benefactor of all living beings, without Ram's special permission, I cannot dare come before him." When Lakshmana reported the matter, Ram immediately commanded, "Whosoever it may be, usher him in without delay." The dog then humbly came before Ram and said, "O Lord, the king is a representation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Thus he is the savior of all creatures. While others sleep peacefully, the king remains alert, always working for the welfare of his subjects. However, since everything depends upon him, when the king is negligent, his subjects soon perish. The king is the upholder of the religious principles and thus curbs the forces of evil. Those who follow religious principles experience happiness in this life and the next. Thus the king receives great merit for sustaining dharma. O Ram, you are the model of a religious king. With my head placed at your lotus feet, I seek your mercy. Do not become angry at what I have to say." Rama reassured the dog, saying, "Go on, speak without fear." Thus encouraged, the dog continued, "A mendicant Brahmana named Sarvatha Siddha has injured my head, although there was no fault on my part." Dandavat Pranam, Prabhuji. Immediately Rama and his men summoned Sarvatha Siddha. Soon thereafter, when the Brahmana came before him, Rama inquired, "Why did you strike this dog? What was his fault?" "Anger is a deadly enemy. It is like a sharp sword that slashes away all of one's virtues. Anger nullifies one long accumulated merit of austerity. Therefore, the wise rid themselves of anger by neglecting it in thought, speech, and actions. O Brahmanas, one's true character cannot remain hidden, No matter how hard one tries to conceal it, misdeeds will always betray those who have not conquered the forces of lust, anger, and greed. Page 542. The Brahmanas replied, I was wandering about begging for alms when I came upon this dog squatting in the middle of the road, blocking my path. I told him, make way, but he got up so slowly that I struck him over the head with my staff. I am famished and my anger was easily aroused. O king, I admit my guilt. You should punish me as you see fit, just to save me from the falling down into the hellish condition of life. Rama turned to his ministers and inquired, what should the punishment be? Justice must be done, for nothing instills more confidence in people's mind than the administration of fair punishment to wrongdoers. Bhrigu, Vasishtha, Kashyapa and other knowers of religious principles replied, a Brahmana is never to be punished. This is the unanimous opinion of those conversant with religious principles. Still, O Ram, you are the ultimate judge, for you are the Lord of the entire universe. You are Lord Vishnu himself. Thus, whatever is spoken by you is eternal religion. The dog interrupted, saying, O king, you have asked, what can I do for you? If you truly wish to please me, then kindly appoint this Brahmana to be head of the Kalanjara monastery. Rama fulfilled the dog's request, and thus the delighted Brahmana, Sarvatha Siddha, became honored as a spiritual leader and was placed atop a magnificently decorated elephant. The ministers, however, became greatly upset, protesting, O king, this cannot be considered a punishment. Rather than putting the Brahmana to shame, you have awarded him an exalted position. Let's see what happens. Do you want to know what happens? Let's see. Rama replied, you do not understand the intricacies of karma, but the dog does. I was just thinking, reading behind, like now the dogs come in bedroom everywhere. Earlier the dog was taking permission to enter the royal palace. Prompted by Ram, the dog explained, in my last life, I was the head of the Kalanjara monastery. I duly worshipped the demigods and brahmanas. I performed my sacred duties carefully and properly maintained the servants and maidservants. Still, regardless of so much care, trying to leave nothing undone, I took my next birth as a dog due to some unknown fault. Now just consider this Brahmana who cannot even control his anger. He is certainly unfit to be a spiritual leader. For his audacity in accepting such a position, he will now degrade 7 generations of his family. How can a man who is unable to control his temper be put in charge of Brahmanas, cows and deity worship? Anyone who steals from the Brahmana, demigod, woman or children is doomed, as is one who takes back a gift that was freely given. Indeed, even the very thought of stealing from the demigod and Brahmana will send a man to the lowest of hells. Saying this, the dog suddenly disappeared, while Ram and the others sat with wide open eyes. Although previously born in a very high family, that living being had somehow been forced to accept the body of a dog. After leaving the royal court at Ayodhya, the dog gave up his life by abstaining from food and water, with the hope of attaining a better birth. One day, while Ram was seated upon the royal throne, Sumantra informed him that some rishis headed by Chavana had come to see him. The sages were then escorted in, bearing gifts of fruits and water collected from holy places. After worshipping the rishi, Rama inquired as to the purpose of their visit. Assuring them he was prepared to execute their command, Chavana Muni replied, my dear Lord Ram, in the Satyayuga, there was a most pious Daitya named Madhu, the son of Loka. Being very pleased with Madhu, Lord Shiva awarded him an invincible lance. Madhu then requested that all his descendants might also possess this lance, but Rudra explained that this was not possible. However, Lord Shiva at last agreed that the lance could be transferred to Madhu's son. Thus, at the time of his death, the Daitya handed over the weapon to his son Lavanasura. O Rama, this offering of Madhu is now residing in Madhuvan. Because he has become very formidable, he is greatly oppressing the rishis. My dear Lord, you have already destroyed Ravana and his followers. We now beg you to please save us from the hands of Lavanasura. You know who will go? Let's read. Rama replied, this is the place near Vrindavan, Mathura. Rama replied, my dear rishis, please give up all anxiety. I shall certainly kill this Rakshasas. Turning to his brother, Rama inquired, Shall I kill this demon myself, or shall I allow the task to Bharata or Shatrughna? Bharata then expressed his eagerness to slay the demon. However, Shatrughna pleaded, "My dear Ram, during your exile, Bharata had to suffer so greatly. Therefore, please grant me permission to destroy Lavanasura." Rama replied, "O Shatrughna, let it be so. Indeed, I shall crown you at once as the king of Madhuvan." Hearing this, Shatrughna felt most ashamed and protested, "O Lord, it is not proper to install a younger brother as king in the presence of his elder brother. However, your words cannot go in vain, and I must carry out your order. I now realize it was wrong to protest Bharata's request. It is unrighteous for a younger brother to oppose his elder brother's wishes. I must have been prompted to do so by my evil stars." Rama was pleased to hear Shatrughna speak this way. He then asked Lakshmana and Bharata to arrange for their brother's coronation at once. Thereafter, when Shatrughna was crowned as the king of Madhuvan, he shone like the radiant sun. The rishis headed by Chyavana were fully assured by this sight. Welcome, Rajesh Prabhu. Rama then said, "My dear Shatrughna, it is Lavanasura's habit to keep his lance inside his house where he goes out to collect food. It is only when he is challenged to fight that he takes up his invincible weapon. Therefore, you must confront the demon when he is outside. When you do this, block his entrance so he may not go into his house. Take 4,000 horse soldiers, 2,000 chariot warriors, and 1,000 infantry with you. Let merchants also accompany you, along with their wares, and bring actors and dancers. Likewise, take 1,000,000 gold coins to pay the soldier's salary. Proceed in a way that will disguise your motive, for only by intercepting him unaware and unarmed will you be able to emerge victorious." Shatrughna first dispatched his army, then 1 month later he set out. After passing 2 nights on the way, Shatrughna reached the ashram of Valmiki. During the third day, Shatrughna explained to Valmiki how he had been dispatched on a mission by the order of Lord Ram, and the rishi extended his hospitality to him. That night, as Shatrughna remained at Valmiki's ashram, Sita gave birth to twin sons at midnight. Receiving the news from his disciples, Valmiki performed the birth rituals with Kushagras to ward off ghosts and Rakshasas. Valmiki then directed some elderly people to rub the body of the firstborn child with the ends of the Kushagras and the younger twin with the lower end of the Kushagras. Thus the elder boy became known as Kusha and the younger boy as Lava, lower end. Shatrughna overheard the news and was very happy to know that twin boys were born to Ram and Sita. In the morning, Shatrughna set out, and after journeying for 7 days, he arrived at the ashram of Chyavana Muni on the banks of Yamuna River. That evening, as they were sitting at ease, Shatrughna inquired from Chyavana Muni about the prowess of Lavanasura. The rishi replied, "O Prince, Shri Shri Radha Madan Mohan Ji Ki Jai, Shri Shri Narasingha Dev Bhagwan Ki Jai, Gauranga Mahaprabhu Ki Jai." Continuing, the rishi replied, "O Prince, there was formerly a very powerful king in the dynasty of Ikshvaku named Mandhata. This king was so ambitious that he made preparations for conquering the entire three worlds. As a consequence, even the demigods became afraid. Indra then approached Mandhata and suggested, 'O king, you should first subjugate the entire earth before thinking of conquering heaven.' With great surprise, Mandhata inquired, 'O Indra, where is that person on earth who has not come under my subjugation?' In reply, the king of heaven named Lavanasura, the son of Madhu, who resided at Madhuvan. Hearing this, Mandhata angrily set out with his army. First, the king sent forth his envoy. But when the envoy arrived at Madhuvana, Lavanasura ate him up. In a great rage, King Mandhata challenged Lavanasura, who thus came out of his city wielding his terrible lance. In an instant, that invincible weapon destroyed King Mandhata's and then returned to the hands of its owner. Therefore, my dear Shatrughna, you must be sure to challenge this demon when he is away from home searching for food." The next morning, Lavanasura went to the forest to hunt for animals. In his absence, Shatrughna crossed the river Yamuna and then besieged the city of Madhuvan. At noon, when Lavanasura returned home bearing heaps of dead animals, he saw Shatrughna standing at the city gates. Lavanasura simply laughed with derision and said, "O fool, regardless of your audacity, All your weapons shall be of no avail. Indeed, it is my great fortune that you have arrived at my meal time. Shatrughna challenged, I am the youngest brother of Lord Ram and Bharat, and my name is Shatrughna. I have come here to slay you as a just reward for your wicked deeds. Lavanasura again laughed heartily, saying, even though Rama killed Ravana, the brother of my aunt, Suparnakha, I merely excused him out of contempt, for I did not consider him worthy of my challenge. A fierce duel ensued between the two warriors. Then Lavanasura suddenly struck Shatrughna over the head with a large tree, causing him to fall unconscious on the ground. Thinking his adversary to be slain, Lavanasura picked up his animal carcasses and entered his city. However, within a moment, Shatrughna came to his senses. Standing up, he fixed a supremely powerful arrow upon his bowstring. Indeed, when the demigods were struck with fear upon seeing the terrible arrow, and they quickly sought the shelter of Lord Brahma, the grandsire explained to them, "By my dear celestial, with this arrow, Lord Vishnu formerly killed Madhu and Kaitaba. Rama was given this arrow to Shatrughna, knowing well that it would be put to use at this time. You should all go witness with your own eyes the death of this great demon." Shatrughna then released that wonderful arrow, and after soaring magnificently through the air, it pierced Lavanasura's heart, making him fall to the ground dead. The victorious Shatrughna shone like the sun, and the demigod praised him for his wonderful achievement. Thereafter, Shatrughna settled at Madhuban, residing there with his army and followers. He built a great city there called Madhupuri, which soon became highly prosperous. It was only after 12 years that Shatrughna at last decided to return to Ayodhya. When Shatrughna came to Ashram of Valmiki, he was very respectfully received by the Rishi and offered ample hospitality. While congratulating Shatrughna for killing the terrible demon Lavanasura, Valmiki smelled his head repeatedly with great affection. After taking his meal, Shatrughna sat down to listen as Lava and Kusha recited Valmiki's composition of the Ramayana to the accompaniment of music. The poetic expressions were so enrapturing and the descriptions of Lord Ram's transcendental pastimes so vivid that tears soon came to Shatrughna's eyes. Even the soldiers became entranced while hearing the history, for they appeared to be reenacted before their eyes in the ashram of Valmiki. One listener exclaimed, "How wonderful this reenactment is. It appears as though we are dreaming. My dear Shatrughna, please ask Valmiki, who has composed this wonderful song." Shatrughna replied, "My dear soldiers, we should not question the Rishi about this, because many wonderful occurrences take place in his ashram. We should not be so astonished or express our curiosity unnecessarily." That night while resting, Shatrughna could think of nothing other than the sweet lyrics describing the pastimes of his worshipable brother Lord Ram. The next morning, Shatrughna departed and soon arrived at Ayodhya. Upon entering the royal palace, Shatrughna saw Ram like a second Indra surrounded by his ministers. Bowing before his elder brother, Shatrughna said, "My dear Ram, I have carried out your command and killed the wicked Lavanasura. Since that time, I have been residing at Madhupuri. By your mercy, it has become extremely prosperous. My dear brother, I am most aggrieved, having lived in separation from you for these past 12 years. Therefore, I beg you to give me permission to now reside in Ayodhya without going anywhere else in the future." Rama feelingly embraced Shatrughna and replied, "My dear brother, you should not speak like this. A heroic Kshatriya must not express the sorrow or feel any inconvenience while living in a distant kingdom. It is the duty of a king to rule over his subjects according to the religious principles. You have to return to Madhupuri. I hope, of course, you may visit Ayodhya from time to time to see me. My dear Shatrughna, you are more dear to me than life itself. Therefore, please stay here for 7 days before setting out." With a sorrowful heart, Shatrughna assented, and after spending 7 days in Ayodhya, he left for his own kingdom. Same thing, you know, when devotees from Navdeep used to come to meet Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in Puri, and then again they used to go after, you know, few months of after Rath Yatra. Because we have to perform our duty, correct? Once an elderly Brahmana villager arrived at the gate of Rama's palace, hearing the body of his child. Delirious with grief, the old Brahmana cried out, "Oh, my son, my dear child, what terrible crime did I commit in previous life to deserve the death of my only child? He was just a child, not yet 14, and how his mother and I shall die from grief. What wrong did I commit? I have never spoken a lie or injured either man or animal. Never before in the kingdom of Ram has a son died before his parents. Therefore, the death of my son must be due to some fault of Ram himself. It is well known that when the king becomes negligent in the performing his duties, that such anomalies occur. O Ram, you must return my innocent son to me, or else my wife and I will give up our lives at your doorstep. In this way, you will become guilty of killing Brahmanas. O king, you claim to be a great ruler in the line of Ikshvaku. How will you be able to go on living happily when the great sins you have perpetrated continue to haunt you? I wish we can go to Obama and say like this, you know, all the problems in California is happening because of the ruler. It's actually true. 1/6 of the credit as well as 1/6 of the sin goes to the king or the leader of the state, as per the Vedas, you know. Rama hurriedly summoned his advisor Markandeya, Maudgalya, Kashyapa, Katyayana, Jabali, Gautama and Narada. After seeing the great rishis and offering them respect, Rama informed them of elderly Brahmana's accusations. To relieve the king's anxiety, Narada said, "O king, I shall disclose to you the reason for the child's death. Then you may act as you see fit. In the Satya Yuga, everyone was spiritually qualified, and by performing austerity, they achieved liberation from the material bondage. In that golden age, wisdom was the rule, and there was no untimely death. Then in the beginning of Treta Yuga, the four social divisions were created. The Kshatriyas were practically as qualified as the Brahmanas, and they were both allowed to perform austerities. In the Dwapar Yuga, irreligiosity will increase, and thus many irregularities will be introduced. As a concession, the Vaishyas will also be allowed to perform austerities, but the Shudra will be strictly forbidden to do so. Thereafter, in the Kali Yuga, even Shudras will be allowed to perform austerities. Indeed, in that degraded age, there will be practically no qualified Brahmana, Kshatriya or Vaishyas."
So they are talking about this?
Yes. That's why it is said in this age of Kali, in Brihadnaradiya Puran, it is said, "Harinam, Harinam, Harinam eva kevalam, kalau nasti eva, nasti eva, nasti eva gati anyata." Lord, and it means that in this age of Kali, full of quarrel and hypocrisy, chanting of the holy names of the Lord, chanting of the holy names of the Lord, chanting of the holy names of the Lord is the only refuge, is the only refuge in the only refuge. So we cannot be like ruling the kingdom like 13,000 years, correct? We cannot find peace. So that's why chanting of the holy names of the Lord is the most beneficial sacrifice in this age of Kali. Even if you look at this beautiful poster on the right, you can see that Lord Ram wanted to build a bridge, correct? And he asked the water god Varuna to give a way for the passage. And then, he said, "Why don't you put your name and then throw?" So when the monkey started putting Shri Ram name and through it the rock was floating. So the name is more powerful than the god itself, you know. Very, very beautiful. Yeah, so this, they are talking about the current age. So, you know, we have still few pages remaining and looks like we are cruising pretty good. "O Rama, it is a serious offense." Good question, Mataji. Yeah, I can see all of you are relishing the literature. "O Ram, it's a serious offense for Shudra to practice austerity in this Treta Yuga. It happens, however, that there is one Shudra in your kingdom executing very severe penances. He is the cause of this child's death. O king, irreligiosity is a state's worst enemy. Therefore, the ruler who fails to punish wrongdoers deserves to suffer in hell. You must find out this culprit at once so this religious principle may be upheld and the Brahmana son may be restored to life. Pleased by this advice, Ram ordered Lakshmana, "Go at once to the palace gate and tell the Brahmana to preserve the dead body of his child in a vat of oil after supplying the necessary herbs." Rama then mentally summoned the Pushpaka chariot, leaving Ayodhya in the care of Lakshmana and Bharata. He departed to search for the culprit. Rama first flew over the western region, then north to the Himalayas. Finding no sign of religion, no sign of irreligion, he next examined the eastern provinces and finally began searching in the south. There, near a great mountain and beside a large lake, Rama sighted an ascetic hanging head downward, engaged in executed severe penances. "What great austerity, what fixed determination," Rama declared. "Tell me, O formidable one, who are you and what is your caste?" "I am Ram, the son of Dashrath, and you have aroused my curiosity. For what purpose are you undergoing so much trouble? Are you seeking the heavenly planets, or have you some other goal? Are you a Brahmana, a heroic Kshatriya, a Vaishya, or a Shudra? Please tell me the truth." From this awkward position, the ascetic replied, "O illustrious king, my name is Shambhuka. I am born the son of Shudra. Regardless of this handicap, I am performing austerity so that in my next life, I can attain the planets of the demigods." Shambhuka had hardly finished speaking when Ram unsheathed his terrible sword and slashed off the Shudra's head. From the sky came shouts of, "Well done, excellent!" As flowers rained down from all sides. Being exceedingly pleased, the demigods appeared before Ram and declared, "O Lord, you have done us a great favor. By performing this noble act, you have ensured that this Shudra will not attain to heaven in violation of religious principles." Correct, it's the Adhikar. With folded hand, Ram replied by requesting the thousand-eyed Indra, "O King of Heaven, if you are truly pleased with me, then kindly restore the Brahmana's son to life. It was due to my own fault that the boy died. I promised the Brahmana that I would restore his life. O best of the demigods, please allow my words to hold true." Indra happily replied, "My dear Lord, certainly the child has already been revived and reunited with his parents. He regained his life as soon as the Shudra's head fell to the ground." There's a footnote, number 10, and we will read. It is understood that a person is born in a Shudra family due to past sinful activities. He must gradually become free from sinful reaction by faithfully serving the higher caste who are engaged in performing pious activities. To attempt to circumvent the proper expiation of sinful reaction and to undertake pious activities for which he is not fit constitutes an aberration of dharma. To punish the Shudra and to check others born in Shudra families from such presumptuousness, Lord Rama, as the ideal king, dedicated to maintain order in society, executed him. However, in the modern age, such rules of dharma do not apply, for even those born in Brahmana families are generally more degraded than Shudras. Got it? For this fallen age, the recommended religious activity for all is chanting the names of Krishna and Ram, which frees one from the sinful reaction and awards love of God, we just discussed about. Correct? Any doubt? Some years later, Ram decided to visit the sage Agastya, who had just completed executing austerities by living within whatever 12 years, accompanied by the demigods on the Pushpaka. So, Agastya was allowed because he was Brahmana, but Shudra was not allowed during that Treta age, correct? Accompanied by the demigods on the Pushpaka chariot, he arrived at the Rishi's ashram. Lord Rama then reverently bowed his head to the Rishi, who in turn received Ram with all due hospitality. Agastya said, "My dear Lord, it is my great fortune that you have come here as my respected guest. Please honor me in return by accepting these golden ornaments manufactured long ago by Vishwakarma." Rama replied, "My dear Rishi, only Brahmanas are permitted to accept charity, not Kshatriyas. The only gift I may receive from you is your valuable words of instruction." See, that's why Rama Rajya was there, because everything was properly executed and thought about. Correct? Agastya said, "My dear Ram, in the Satya Yuga there were no kings. Thus, one day the people went to Lord Brahma and requested him to assign him a ruler. In response, Lord Brahma called for the principal demigods and commanded them to donate various portions of their potencies. Thereafter, Lord Brahma sneezed, and from his nostrils was born a king named Shupa. Lord Brahma endowed Shupa with a portion of Indra's energy so that he could rule over the earth, a portion of Varuna's energy for the maintenance of his body, a portion of Koera's energy for the possession of wealth, and a portion of Yamaraj's energy for chastising wrongdoers. My dear Lord Ram, in the same spirit, you should take these celestial ornaments from me. Ram replied, My dear Rishi, I accept your words and I will accept the ornaments. Now please describe how you came to possess them. Agastya replied, Long ago, during the present Treta Yuga, I performed penances in the vast forest. I originally entered the forest out of curiosity. Thus I found a desolate, enchanting ashram. After passing the night there, however, I found a dead body lying on the ground. To my surprise, I was struck by the beauty of the corpse and stared at it for some time. Suddenly, a celestial chariot descended from the sky. Within it was an effulgent person surrounded by Gandharvas and Apsaras, who were singing and dancing. That splendorous person got down from the chariot and began to feed on the dead body. I was astonished to see this and asked him, Alas, how is that you can do such an abominable act? That person replied, O Rishi, my name is Shweta. I am the son of the illustrious Sudeva and my brother is Suratha. After the death of my father, the citizens made me their king. Then after ruling for a great while, I considered my duration of life was coming to an end. Thus I retired to the forest after installing my brother Suratha on the royal throne. Finally, after executing severe austerities for 3,000 years, I ascended to Brahma Loka. However, I was surprised to find that I am still afflicted by great pangs of hunger and thirst. I therefore inquired, My dear Lord Brahma, the residents of your supreme abode are free from such disturbances. How then I am suffering from hunger and thirst? The grand sire replied, O Shweta, although you have performed penances for a long time, you never gave in charity. Thus for the reason you now suffer from hunger and thirst, even here in Brahma Loka. Now to appease you, I ordain that human flesh shall be your meal. O king, you shall suffer the effects of this curse until you meet the great sage Agastya. Agastya then said, My dear Lord Ram, as arranged by destiny, I one day came to meet Shweta. In gratitude for being relieved from his distress, he begged me to accept these ornaments. Rama inquired, My dear Rishi, why is that this place where Shweta formerly performed austerities is devoid of all beasts and birds? Agastya replied, My dear Ram, in the Sata Yuga, there lived a great king named Manu, who was the founder of the social system, consisting of the four occupational duties. Later, Manu's son Ikshvaku inherited the kingdom. In his turn, he begot 100 sons. The youngest son of Ikshvaku was very dull and never obeyed his brothers. Thus, he received the name Danda. Danda founded the kingdom that extends between the Vindhya mountain and the Shaivala mountain. His capital city was named Madhumantra, and Shukracharya became his sacrificial priest. One day, after having ruled over the kingdom for a long time, Danda went to visit the ashram of Shukra. Upon his arrival, he happened to see the Rishi's beautiful daughter, Araja, loitering there alone, the very sight of her causing the king to immediately be overcome by lust. Danda forcibly embraced Araja and proceeded to gratify himself with her against her will. The king then returned to his capital. Soon thereafter, Shukra was informed by a disciple of what has happened. When he returned to his ashram, his daughter was there, shedding tears. The Rishi angrily cursed the king, saying, Let Indra devastate Danda's entire kingdom by raining down dust for 7 days, so that everything becomes buried and all creatures die. Shukra then ordered the residents of his ashram to leave that forest and commanded Araja to continue living there in trance. O Ram, Shukra's curse soon took effect, and from the time onwards, this forest is known as Dandakaranya. Anybody who wish to get a copy of Ramayana can get, and please make a donation of $10 that goes in procuring such books. Lord Ram passed the night at Agastya's ashram and the next morning departed for Ayodhya. Soon after his return, Lord Rama expressed his desire to perform the Rajasuya Yagna, an elaborate sacrifice that established who is the emperor of the world by subduing all the kings therein. Bharata said, My dear elder brother, all the kings of the earth look upon you just like a father. Therefore, you should not do anything that will cause them to suffer. All of these kings are fully obedient to you, and thus you should not threaten them with destruction by performing this sacrifice. Lord Ram gladly accepted Bharata's advice. Lakshmana then proposed that he perform a horse sacrifice instead. Lakshmana cited how Indra formally became freed from all sinful reaction after the slaying of Ritasura by performing a horse sacrifice. In turn, Ram pointed out how Ila, the son of Kardamma, regained his manhood by a similar sacrifice. Lord Ram had Lakshmana call for the great rishis Vasishtha, Vamadeva, Jabali and Kashyapa. After receiving their approval, he sent out invitations to Sugriva, Vibhishana and all the other kings friendly to him. The challenge horse was then released to wander at will. Thereafter, the great sacrifice commenced at Naimisharanya. Let's read one paragraph again. Mataji, you can start. Just, yeah, page 557.
As kings and princes poured in from all over the world, Bharata and Shatrughna received them with great hospitality. Sugriva and the other monkeys were assigned to look after the entertainment, while Vibhishana and the other Rakshasas were assigned to attend to the comforts of the rishis. During the sacrificial performance, charity and food were distributed in profusion. No one could be seen who appeared to be neglected. Indeed, wealth and clothing were heaped as high as hills all around the sacrificial arena. Thus the festivities continued for one full year as the challenge horse roamed the earth under the protection of Lakshmana.
Next.
Meanwhile, Valmiki called for Lava and Kusha and instructed them, please go out and continue reciting Ramayana throughout the land. Go to the homes of Brahmanas, the ashramas of Rishis, and the palaces of great kings. Chant the Ramayana while wandering through the city streets and countryside. However, please first go to Ayodhya, where Ram is now engaged in performing a great horse sacrifice. If Ram invites you to chant before the assembled Brahmanas, please do so. Chant 20 chapters at a time and don't accept any payment in return. Simply say, what good is gold for those who subsist upon fruits and roots?
Thank you so much. Next, Pala Prabhu.
Yes.
Page 558. One paragraph.
If Rama inquires, whose sons are you? Then reply, we are Valmiki's disciples. Chant the verses of Ramayana very sweetly, taking care that nothing displeases the king, for he is considered to be the father of all living beings.
Thank you.
Lava and Kusha replied, we shall do as you say. That night, they slept peacefully with Valmiki's words firmly fixed in their hearts. Thereafter, it came to pass that Lava and Kusha began to recite the epic Ramayana in the sacrificial arena at Ayodhya, accompanied by stringed instruments. Indeed, the two brothers had voices that made their recitations appear more melodious than the singing of Gandharvas.
You can give it to Prabhu behind.
The audience was enthralled by their artistry. Likewise, Rama listened intently, filled with great curiosity. Turning to one another, people remarked, except for their matted hair and deerskin dress, these boys exactly resemble Lord Rama himself. After listening to the first 20 chapters, Rama ordered Lakshmana, give these noble-minded boys 20,000 gold coins, costly garments, and whatever else they desire.
Next. However,
when Lakshmana offered these rewards, Lava and Kusha refused, saying, what is the use of gold for ascetics who live on fruits and roots? Highly astonished, Rama inquired, "How many parts are there in this epic poem, and which Rishi composed it?"
Thank you. Malli Mataji, whenever you are ready. The twins replied, "O King, the great sage Valmiki is our spiritual master, and he is the author of this great literature that depicts the entire history of your life. The poem consists of 6 parts, and a 7th describes your concluding pastimes. If you desire, we shall recite the entire Ramayana during the period of your sacrifice." Sure? Thereafter, Ram listened with the unbound pleasure as Lava and Kusha recited the Ramayana. For many days, at last, Rama concluded, "These boys must be the twin sons of Sita. There's no doubt of it." Rama's heart melted due to the affection for his son. After considering the matter very deeply, he called for messengers of impeccable etiquettes. He ordered them, "Go at once to the ashram of the great sage Valmiki and speak to him the following words. If Sita is indeed blameless, if her character is faultlessly pure, then let her come here with your sanction so that she can prove her innocence before all the assembled citizens. O messengers, please hurry back with the replies. Let Sita come tomorrow at dawn and establish her purity in my presence." When Sita heard Rama's proposal, she could not comply, for she considered such a public trial a great humiliation. Thus coming to a firm decision in her mind, Sita dressed herself in reddish cloth and started for Ayodhya with Valmiki. A large crowd had assembled from all over the Kaushal kingdom, for everyone was very curious to see Sita. Indeed, all of the demigods, headed by Lord Brahma, as well as the foremost rishis, Nagas, Siddhas, and other celestial beings, came to witness the trial of Sita's purity. Finally, Valmiki arrived, followed by Sita, her head bent low, her hands joined in supplication. Tears filled her large eyes, and Lord Ram was firmly fixed in her heart. As the assembled citizens murmured in anticipation, Valmiki approached Lord Ram and said, "O son of Dasharatha, here is the impeccably righteous Sita, whom you abandoned out of fear of public scandal. She has come here to prove her purity, thus she awaits your command. O Ram, I have never uttered a lie. Make the following declaration. If Sita is tainted by even the slightest guilt, then may the result of my accumulated austerities prove eternally fruitless. Although you love Sita deeply and were convinced of her innocence, you still discarded her out of fear of public opinion. By dint of my spiritual vision, I can understand Sita's complete purity. Thus I come to proclaim this truth to you." Rama gazed upon Sita for a moment and announced to the assembly, "So be it." Mataji, last 10 pages you can do. I'll tell you. 565. "Be it so. I accept all that great rishis has said. Previously the demigod also testified as to Sita's purity and I happily took her back to Ayodhya. However, people began to criticize me. Thus, with great reluctance, I sent her away. Now I have decided that if Sita can prove her innocence before this assembly, then I shall again accept her as the wife I dearly love." Everyone fell silent and all eyes became fixed upon Sita, who stood with her gaze lowered and her head bent slightly downward. After a short pause, Sita said to the assembly, "O goddess of the earth, please hear my petition. If, since the time of my marriage, I have a thought of anyone but Ram, or if I loved my if I ever loved any man but Ram, then refuse me shelter. However, if I only dwelt in Ram in thought, word and action, then please give me a place within you so I need not experience the shame of facing this slanderous people." While Sita spoke, the earth suddenly opened up, and from the crevice the goddess Bhumi majestically rose up, seated upon a golden throne borne by divine serpents. The goddess welcomed Sita, took her in arms, and seated her at her side on the throne. Then while from the sky and from the earth, the demigods and rishis, kings and common people looked on to the astonishment, the celestial throne slowly descended into the bowels of the earth. There was an uproar as all humans uttered exclamations of wonder, praising Sita for her glorious confirmation of her purity. From the heavens the demigods rained down showers of flowers, and there was singing, dancing and playing of musical instruments. After Sita disappeared from sight, tears welled up in Rama's eyes, and anger flared within his mind. Rama lowered his head and declared, Earth, I order you to return Sita immediately. Open up and bring her here so I may again be united. Sita is your daughter and I am your son-in-law. Give me Sita without delay or I shall crush your mountains, burn your forests and smash you into atoms. Lord Brahma then spoke to appease the raving, tortured Ram. Oh Lord, please remember your identity. You are the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu, and Sita is the goddess of fortune herself. Sita has now entered the planet of the Nagas and very shortly she will be reunited with you in your transcendental abode, Vaikuntha. O Supreme Hero, Lord of the universe and maintainer of all that lives, why must I remind you of your divine position? O Ram, give up your grief and hear from your sons the concluding portion of the great narration that describes your transcendental pastimes. This epic poem composed by Valmiki will spread your glories throughout the three worlds for as long as the universe continues to exist. Saying this, Lord Brahma disappeared. We'll have continued reading by Malini Mataji. Oh, Prabhu, you want to come? Come, come. Lord Shri Ramchandra ki jai, Lord Lakshman Bhagwan ki jai, Sita Mai ki jai, Hanuman ji ki jai.
So which paragraph exactly?
562
page 4. This one. Yeah. O Rama, give up your grief and hear from your sons the concluding portion of the great narration that describes your transcendental pastime. This epic poem composed by Valmiki will spread your glories throughout the three worlds for as long as the universe continues to exist. Saying this, Lord Brahma disappeared. Rama went to Valmiki's ashrama with Lava and Kusha. After passing the night grieving over the loss of Sita, Rama summoned all the rishis and requested his sons to recite the Uttarakhanda of the Ramayana. Thereafter, Rama returned to Ayodhya but found life barren without his beloved Sita. Rama continued to rule over the kingdom strictly according to the religious principles. Thus the rains showered forth regularly, crops were abundant, and everywhere were the signs of prosperity. Then after the passage of many years, Kaushalya passed away, then Sumitra, and then Kaikeyi. So they all became reunited with Maharaj Dasharatha in the transcendental realm. Sometime thereafter, Yudhajit, the king of Kekaya, came to see Lord Rama at Ayodhya, requesting him to conquer the Gandharva king who resided north of the river Indus. Rama immediately appointed Bharata's two sons, Taksha and Pushkala, as rulers of the Gandharva kingdom. Bharata then proceeded with a large army and established Taksha in Takshashila and Pushkala in Pukshalavati. Finally, after 5 years passed, Bharata returned to Ayodhya. Rama then made Lakshmana's two sons Angada and Chandraketu the rulers of Karupata after bringing that territory under subjugation. Lakshmana had accompanied his two sons and returned to Ayodhya after an absence of 1 year. Since the closing of Lord Rama's earthly pastime was close at hand, time personified came to Ayodhya one day in the guise of a wandering ascetic. After arriving at the palace gate, time announced Lakshmana, "I am a messenger from Lord Brahma. Since I have come on a very important mission, I desire to see Lord Rama at once." When time in the form of the dazzling effulgent rishi entered the palace, Rama respectfully seated him upon a golden throne and inquired, "O Holy One, what is the nature of your visit? Is there some message you have come to deliver?" The messenger replied, "O King, if you honor the wishes of Lord Brahma, then our meeting must be held in private, for his words are not meant for others. Indeed, let it be known for certain that anyone who overhears our conversation will soon meet with death. O Rama, you must promise that if anyone comes and interrupts our meeting, then you will unhesitatingly give up all connections with him. Rama replied, let it be so. To Lakshmana, he ordered, dismiss the doorman. I want you to personally guard the entrance, for this meeting must be strictly private. Thereafter, when the two were alone, Death in the form of a messenger said, in the previous birth I was a son of Lord Brahma. Now I am appearing as all-lowering eternal time Kala. O King, the universal grandsire speaks unto you the following words. O Lord Rama, O Supreme Personality of Godhead, I offer my obeisances unto you. After the dissolution of the universe, you sleep in the waters of devastation in the form of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. Then when there is need for creating the universe as it was before, I, Lord Brahma, take birth from the effulgent lotus that grows from my navel. After my birth, I was entrusted with the creation of the three worlds. In turn, I requested you to assume the form of Shridhodakshaya Vishnu to become the maintainer of the universe. Ever since that time, you have appeared in many transcendental forms whenever there is a need to relieve the burden of the world. Now you have appeared to kill Ravana and rule over the earth for 11,000 years. O Lord, since this allotted time is now concluded, you need no longer remain within this material world. If you so desire, you may once again ascend to the heaven to resume your rule over the demigods. O all-pervading Supreme Personality of Godhead, you are the source of my strength and my very existence. Let me therefore offer my respectful obeisances unto you. After listening to Kala, Rama smiled and replied, you have spoken truthfully. May there all be good fortune for you. You may now go and tell Lord Brahma that because I have fulfilled the purpose of the demigod, I will very soon return to my transcendental abode. As Rama and the messenger were conversing, it happened that Durvasa Muni arrived at that royal place. When Lakshmana went to receive him, the Rishi insisted, I am here on most urgent business and must see Lord Rama at once. Lakshmana replied, Rama has given me strict orders that he cannot be interrupted under any circumstance. O foremost of the Rishis, please be patient and wait for a short while. At this, Durvasa lost his temper. With fiery eyes, he screamed, go and announce my presence at once. If you are so foolish to disobey me, then I shall curse Rama, Bharata, and yourself and the entire Ikshvaku dynasty and the entire Kosala kingdom. Hurry for my patience, Vastan. Lakshmana knew that to interrupt Rama's conversation with Kala would soon bring about his own death. However, thinking of Durvasa's question concluded, it is better if I suffer alone rather than cause everyone's ruination. Lakshmana then entered the room, being informed of Durvasa's arrival. Rama took leave of Kala and hurriedly went out to meet the Rishi. As he stood before Durvasa Muni with us folded hands, Rama inquired, O foremost of ascetic Brahma, what can I do to please you? Durvasa replied, O righteous king, I have just now completed a 1,000-year fast. What can you give me to eat? Thereafter, Rama provided Durvasa with a sumptuous feast and the Rishi was highly gratified. After Durvasa's departure, however, Rama remembered the promise he made to Kala. Thus, a horrible grief overtook him. Fearing the loss of his most intimate associate, Rama stood as though deprived of reason, his head bowed in dejection. Lakshmana then approached his aggrieved brother and cheerfully said, O Rama, do not lament, for that is that which is inevitable under the control of supreme destiny. Duty must be carried out without attachment or aversion. Therefore, keep your promise and banish me without hesitation. Rama summoned his ministers, and after describing all that had happened, he asked for their advice. Finally, after a long silence, Vasishtha said, My dear Rama, by dint of my ascetic prowess, I could foresee all this happening to you. Now you must keep your promise. Otherwise, your lifelong adherence to righteousness will be blighted. With the decay of religious principles, the world gradually comes to perish. Therefore, adhere to truthfulness and banish Lakshmana. Rama appeared to think deeply over the matter. Then he announced to the assembly, adhering to righteousness, I hereby order the banishment of Lakshmana from Ayodhya. The ministers all applauded Rama's decision, and thereafter Lakshmana went to the banks of the river Sarayu and absorbed his mind in the practice of mystic yoga. Then when the time became ripe, King Indra suddenly appeared there, riding in a celestial chariot. Thus, in his Selfsame transcendental body, Lakshmana ascended to the heaven amidst the singing of Gandharvas, the dancing of Apsaras, and showers of fragrant flowers. After Lakshmana's disappearance, Rama decided to install Bharata upon the royal throne so that he could be free to follow Lakshmana's path. However, Bharata refused to occupy the throne, for he preferred to accompany Rama to the forest rather than enjoy the kingdom without him. Rama then divided the kingdom between his sons, giving Kusha the northern part of Kosala and Lava the southern part. After the coronation, Rama embraced his twin sons and then presented them vast amounts of gold, jewels, thousands of chariots and countless horses and elephants. When the citizens heard of Rama's intention to retire to the forest, they became determined to follow him. Their grief due to the impending separation was unbearable. Shatrughna was also intent upon following Rama, and thus when the Lord finally came out of the city, there was a great procession following him. Indeed, because of their love and devotion, every living entity followed Rama to the forest, so that not even an animal could be seen in Ayodhya. While Rama silently walked along, everyone could see that he was exhibiting the mood of a complete detachment and indifference, as if preparing to give up the world. All of Rama's potency appeared in personified form to accompany him. Shri walked on Rama's right side and Bhumi on his left. Shakti walked in front, and innumerable other energies followed Rama, including Omkar, Gayatri and the Vedas. Next, Shatrughna and his family followed Bharata. Then came the Brahmanas who tended the sacrificial fire. Behind the Brahmanas who walked all the citizens according to their positions, following them came all the animals. When he arrived at the bank of river Sarayu, Rama paused. At that time, Lord Brahma and the demigods appeared overhead in their celestial chariots. The sky was thus lit up with a transcendental radiance, and gentle, sweet-smelling breezes began to blow. The Gandharvas and the Apsaras sang and danced, and the demigods showered the most fragrant of celestial flowers. As Lord Rama entered the water, Lord Brahma offered his prayer as follows. O Lord, O Supreme Personality of Godhead, you are now concluding your earthly pastimes and are preparing to return to your transcendental abode beyond this material world. You are the eternal Lord Vishnu, and although you appear in various incarnations, your body is unchanging and original. It is you alone who are the cause of all causes and the support of all existence. Everything is thus part and parcel of you, for you are the Supreme Absolute Truth, the source of all emanation. O Lord, you have so kindly appeared to remove the burden of the earth, and thus let us offer our respectful obeisances unto you again and again. Followed by Bharata and Shatrughna, Lord Rama thus returned to his eternal abode in the spiritual sky. Indeed, not only the sons of Dashrata, but all of their followers attained the Vaikuntha planet where the Lord Rama eternally resides. This concludes the transcendental narration of the pastimes of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Ramachandra, known as Ramayana, composed by the great Rishi and devotee Valmiki. This epic should only be recited by those who have implicit faith in the Supreme Lord, for it is non-different from Lord Vishnu himself. Hearing even a single verse has the potency to eradicate all sins committed by a person that day. Therefore, those who seek liberation from the cycle of repeated birth and death always relish this great transcendental literature. The recitation of Ramayana grants one all the fruits of Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha. Beyond that, it helps one to advance towards life's ultimate goal, the development of love of Godhead. May the readers of this book thus become blessed and inspired in Krishna consciousness. May the transcendental forms of Lord Ramachandra and Sita forever remain situated within their hearts. Om Tat Sat. Jai Sita Ram Lakshman Bhakta Hanuman Ki Jai.